We have to remember, we have a Father who wants to hear from us. He wants to be there when we're celebrating, and He wants to be there when, well, when we need to confess our sins. If we had a God who was a dead God, that wouldn't make any difference. But we have to remember, our God is alive, and He wants to be a part of our life. All of it. Come on, let's sing the song, God is Alive, and remember that when we confess our sins, it's to our Father we're confessing them. He wants to forgive it. So come along and let's do that song together. I remember one day when one of my kids came home and they did something wrong, and I knew they did it. And so as much as I wanted to be close to them, that sin was getting in the way. But when they confessed that sin to me, I was able to draw close to them again. It wasn't that I ever stopped loving them, it's just that sin got in the way of our relationship. That's why we confess our sins to God after we're believers, to keep close to Him. We're gonna do a song called Close. And remember why we want to confess our sins to God. Excited about today's DT. I got my running shoes, I've got my water bottle, and I have a backpack. What are we doing that I would need all these things? Well, today we're going to be racing through an obstacle course. I love obstacle courses. First, you got to set one up. How do you set up an obstacle course? You use chairs, you use furniture, you use your dad, whatever. But you're gonna use things you find around your house to set up an obstacle course. Things you can crawl under, go around, jump over, jump on, whatever. But there's a catch to this obstacle course. This is where the backpack comes in. Now the shoes, the water bottle, totally understand those in an obstacle course. Gotta go fast, gotta refresh. The backpack, your parents are gonna fill this backpack with something really heavy, like rocks or bricks or weights, or if you really want to get crazy, sand. You know, you're gonna have to carry this bag with you as you run through the obstacle course. Now, once your obstacle course and heavy bags are all ready to go, have someone time you, race through the course, and let's see how long it takes. Then come on back and I'll have some more instructions for you. Ready? Let's go. so hard. How did that go? How'd it go for you guys? Did you enjoy the obstacle course with the heavy bag? Or did it slow you down? You know what? I think I want to try it once without the heavy bag. I didn't even remember to change my shoes. I was going so fast. Let's try it again without the heavy bag. What do you think? Yeah, let's do that. So let's time it again. Throw that heavy bag away. Put your shoes on this time. Fill up your water bottle. Let's do it again and let's see how it goes. Come on back when you're done. All right, you guys, did the obstacle course go better when the heavy load had been lifted, when you put that backpack down? I bet it did. You know, carrying around our sin and shame can feel a lot like carrying a bag full of heavy weights. In Psalm 38, we see David calling his and our sin a burden. We need to confess that sin, be forgiven, and have that burden lifted. Romans 15:4 says that everything was written in the past to teach us. So it makes sense that if we want to learn, we should go to the book of no right points, the Bible, and see if there's anything in there that could teach us how to get rid of this burden. So you know what? Let's open our Bibles. Let's open them to Luke 15:11. Where's that found? Well, we're over here where Jesus is teaching. So we're in the New Testament. Jesus is teaching about a parable. You know, what's happening? You know, so when we look at a parable, every parable has a point to it, and the point is the same. It's always salvation. That keeps it pretty easy. A parable is a story that Jesus tells to make a point. So what is happening in this lesson? Well, different kinds of people have gathered around to listen to Jesus. Luke 15:1, if we were to go back there, says that all the tax gatherers and sinners were coming near to him to listen to him. And both the Pharisees and the scribes started to grumble. Why? He was doing miracles. He was casting out demons. He was creating food out of nothing. Well, there's two types of people there. There's those who believe in Jesus as their savior, and there's those who don't. The ones who don't, well, either they're just interested in him doing those miracles for them, or they're like the Pharisees and the scribes, and they want to destroy him. So who's a Pharisee? Well, a Pharisee is a person who was very religious and thought they could earn their way to heaven by what they did. They needed to keep the laws. It's religion versus relationship. If you remember way back when we talked about that, well, they were all about religion. Here's the problem. It doesn't matter if you're a tax gatherer, a sinner, a scribe, or a Pharisee. They all have the same problem. It's in Romans 3:23. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. So let's get to our parable. Well, one day Jesus was talking to some of these men. He told them the following parable to teach them something they needed to understand. And remember, the point is salvation, right? So open your Bibles to that Luke 15:11. Hopefully you've got it. We're going to read 11 and 12. There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, "Father, give me my share of the estate." So he divided his property between them. Okay, let's stop there. So we have two sons. We have a younger. This would be our younger son. Say hi, younger son. And we have an older son. Now the older son's just a little bit bigger because he's older. That would just make sense, right? So we've got an older son here and a younger son here. Perfect. So now we have two boxes and we have two sons. And so the younger son goes to the dad and he says, well, maybe I should just show you a video. All right, maybe you remember this from Willy Wonka when she said, I want it and I want it now. Let's insert that.
Hey, Daddy, I want a golden goose.
Here we go again.
All right, sweetheart, all right. Daddy will get you a golden goose as soon as we get home.
No, I want one of those.
Wonka, how much do you want for the golden goose?
They're not for sale.
Name your price.
She can't have one.
Who says I can't?
The man with the funny hat.
I want one. I want a golden goose.
What do you guys think? That's the younger son. He said he wants his inheritance. That's a big word. What does inheritance mean? Well, it's like when a parent dies or someone dies, they leave their valuables to people they love. And so, like my wedding ring. Well, I'm going to leave my wedding ring to one of my children when I die. How would I feel if they came and asked me for it now? I want that ring now. No, you can't have it. You only get it when I'm dead. Well, that's kind of what the younger son was saying to the father. He was almost saying, I wish you were dead so I could have your stuff. Ouch. Look at how angry he looks. He looks like he's, give me my stuff. The older son probably was a little shocked at what happened here, right? But here's the thing. The older son, by the Middle Eastern culture, would have gotten 2/3 of the father's estate. The younger son would have gotten 1/3. So he gets twice as much as him. So as much as he's shocked, there's probably part of him that's like, I like that cash. The younger son, guess what? Shame on him. Shame, shame, shame. That's what the Pharisees would be thinking when Jesus told them this part of the story. And he says, that son went to his father and demanded the estate. They would have been like, that is so shameful. Well, let's see what happens next. In Luke 13 or 15, 13 through 16, it says this. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had and set off for a distant country. And there he squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and he hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to the fields to feed the pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. What? What happened here? Well, first of all, if he left just a few days after he asked his father for the money, how would the father get the money so fast? He would have had to sell off what he had super cheap, kind of like a big rummage sale. You know, he would have said, all this stuff I worked my whole life for, he would have given it away dirt cheap just so he could have gotten it gone fast enough for the son to have it. And then he left the father. So really, he just wanted what the father could give him. He didn't really want the father or a relationship with the father itself, himself. Distant country. He went far, far away. Why? He wanted to be as far away from the father as possible. The younger son, he made a mess out of his life. Now, right now he's still kind of feeling mad, but I'll tell you what. He spent all the money. There was no food in the land. He's working with pigs. He's actually willing to eat the pig food. I mean, that would be like, I mean, I have a dog. That would be like me eating like, don't do that. Yeah, don't eat. Yeah, we don't eat animal food. It doesn't taste good to humans. I mean, he wouldn't eat the pig food. Pigs were considered the dirtiest of all animals, let alone to eat the pig slop. No. Why did all this happen to the younger brother? Three-letter word, starts with an S. Say it with me. Sin, right. Why did he make the sinful choices? Well, sinful choices are selfish choices. They're choices that go against what our father wants. That's exactly what this story is telling us. He forgot what he knew to be true about the father. The great news is, if we keep reading though, he remembers. So right now, he has made a mess of his life. So let's just, He has made a mess of his life. Oh, he is so sad. He has made a mess of his life. So here we go. Let's read 15, 17 through 20. All right. So when he came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have food to spare? And here I am starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. So he got up and went to his father. Now what just happened? Well, he had made a mess of his life and he realized it. He came to his senses. This is what happens to anybody who has to come back to the Father after they make a mess of their life or realize their sinfulness. He came to his senses. He remembered the truth about his Father. He had his no right point down. All right, now think about this. In Middle Eastern times, you would hire people for a day to work for you, and you would only pay them for that day. That way they would come back the next day, right, because they wanted to get paid again. Well, this father was so generous, he paid them more than enough. So the son, when he remembered the father, he remembered correctly. The father is generous, he's kind. And then he says, you know what? I need to turn away from my sinful life and go back to the Father. This is a word you've probably heard called repent. Now, repent is a military term, and it basically means about face. So we're going to practice that together, okay? So I'm going to say repent, you're going to say about face and turn around. Because when we turn away from our sin, it means we're turning towards something else. This parable shows us what happens. Turning away from your sin means turning toward the Father. Right, for those of you who got that, nice job. Star for you. All right, here we go. So I'm going to yell repent. You're going to go about face and go whoop. And then I'm going to say it again. Repent, and you're going to come back around to do a 360 back to me, okay? So here we go. Ready? Repent. Nice, okay? Hopefully right now your back is towards me. I'm going to do it again. Ready? Repent. Hey, nice to have you back. Perfect. So right, it's an about face. This son took responsibility. He saw his sin. He didn't play victim. Woe is me. He didn't do that. He saw that his sin was against heaven, against the Father, and he humbled himself to return. So he'd rather be a worker for the Father than to be a son away from the Father. He saw this burden and he said, I need to get away from it. So let's think about the burden. So if we were to look at the burden, oof. His sin was like a burden. You know, this was him saying to his father, I mean, this is going to be heavy, kind of like the bricks in your backpack. All right, so he says, oh, that was a burden. I don't want to be near my father. And then he said, yeah, and then I took all my father's hard-earned money. Ooh, I made him sell it off real cheap so I could have it. Ooh, and then I distanced myself from that father, too, because I didn't want anything to do with him. Yeah, and then I squandered everything. Squandering means to waste it, to just throw it away on I don't know, PlayStations and Xboxes maybe, I don't know. But he did all that. He says, so now he's got this burden he's carrying around. Now, if you remember back to your obstacle course, that's what he's feeling like too. He's got all this weight, right? Our sin is a burden, right? So let's keep reading and see what the father does when the son returns. With this burden inside, I bet he's returning pretty sluggishly, like, right? But let's see. Luke 15:20 continues and says, but while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. Say what? Wait, now the Pharisees at this point would have been like, shame on that son. His sin is a burden, but he makes his way to the father. Now, Middle Eastern men don't run and they don't show their legs. Now, as this boy came into the village, people would have mocked him. They would have known what he had done. They would have made fun of him, maybe bullied him, and made him feel even more shameful. And the Pharisees would say that the son should be fully shamed. They would say, that's right. He needs to repay everything through hard labor, even if it takes the rest of his life. But the father shouldn't accept him back in at all. So is that what the father did? Well, it's what everybody would have expected. The villagers would have expected that. The Pharisees and scribes who were listening would have expected that. But no, the father doesn't do that. The father takes the shame on himself. He runs. Runs! Now, they wore these long tunics, so he would have had to lift that tunic up to run, which would have showed his bare legs. And they don't run, remember? So he's taking the shame on himself. Plus, he must have been looking for the son, because scripture says he saw him when he was still far off. He drops everything before anybody can shame that son. The father then steps in to take the focus off the son and put it on himself. Remember, in order to run that fast, he'd had to lift his tunic and run. Now, running is a no-no. Lifting the tunic to show the leg, double no-no. Pharisees at this time who are listening are in complete complete disbelief. There is no way a father would do that after having been wronged. But wait, they're in for more shock. They better hold on to their own tunics now. The father not only took the son's shame, Scripture tells us he also felt compassion. Wait, he felt bad for the son? After what the son did to him, he felt bad for the son? He threw his arms around him and kissed him? Kissed him to welcome him back? This is off the no-no chart for the Pharisees. No, 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 no father would do that. Let's see what the son's response was. In verse 21, it tells us, the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Wow! The son saw what a mess he made on the outside. He realized the burden of sin he carried on the inside. He admitted his sin to the father and asked for forgiveness. What do you think the father did? Do you think he slapped him with wet noodles? Do you think he pulled his nose hairs out one by one? Well, let's find out what happened. Verse 22 to 24 tells us, the father said to his servants, quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and he is alive again. He was lost, but he is found. And so they began to celebrate. What? The Pharisees would have been like, no way. The best robe? That would have been the father's robe. The ring they put on his finger, a signet ring, means that he was given all the authority the father had by wearing the father's signet ring. The fattened calf, that was the best one. This would be like Turkey Tom on Thanksgiving Day, like the fattest turkey. This was time to celebrate. How many people does it take for heaven to celebrate? One. One sinner that repents. One person that realized their burden and asked for forgiveness from the father. This son was dead and he is now alive. They would have actually had a funeral for him when he left, but he became alive when he remembered who the father was, repented about face of his sin, turned back to the father and asked for forgiveness. What do you think that looks like? I mean, how do you get rid of this burden? Well, that son, when he was forgiven by the father, is now feeling no longer miserable, no longer angry. He's feeling content to be with the father. Let's see what happened to that burden. Look what happens. The burden's been lifted. The burden's been, when you go to God and ask for forgiveness, he lifts that burden. What do you think the Pharisees are doing and thinking now? No way. Their jaws are on the floor. Shake my head for sure. Right? That's okay. There's still someone in the story that they will be very pleased with. It's the older son. He is angry. So when he finds out what happens, he is going to be very, very angry. Let's read. Meanwhile, the older son, he was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard the music and dancing. He called one of the servants and asked him, "What's going on?" "Your brother has come," he replied, "and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound." The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he said, "Look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours who squandered your property with prostitutes comes home, you kill the fattened calf for him?" Yeah, he's got this box very clean on the outside, right? He stayed with the father. He obeyed all the rules. Probably not, but he thinks he did. The Pharisees can totally relate with this. This is them. But what about the inside? You know, when we think about the inside for him, he's got his own burden. He really didn't want to be with the father. He just wanted the father's stuff too. He wants what the father can give him, just like the younger brother did in the beginning of all this. He considers the relationship with the father one of a worker and an employee. He wants the father's stuff, but he doesn't really want the father. These are burdens, just like the younger sons were. It's a little harder to see that, though, because, you know, he's so clean on the outside. Did he love the father? No. What about the younger brother? At the story's start, he didn't love the father either. But when the story ends, he did. Who does the older son represent? The Pharisees, right. Notice what it says, though. The father invited him into the party, too. The invitation's open to everybody. But what would he have to do? The same thing as him. Repent. Remember the goodness of the Father. Ask the Father to take the burden. This brings up a good point. Is there anyone who doesn't have a burden to be lifted? No. Remember Romans 3:23? All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. The older son needs to get rid of his burden if he's going to be close to the Father, just like the younger son. But let's see what happens. The father says, "My son," the father said, "you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." The father told the older son what good gifts he could have too, if only he would realize and receive them. The Bible doesn't tell us what the older son ended up doing. Did he realize he was wrong and join the party, share in the happiness, or did he stay angry? And what about the Pharisees and the teachers of the law? Did they understand that they were actually the older brother? They knew right, but they didn't do right. Maybe a few did, but we just don't know. What about you guys? When we think about our know right, think right, do right, and feel right points, how are you feeling about this? Are you feeling like you've got a burden of sin that needs to be confessed? Have you confessed of that sin? In this parable, the Father is God. He's so good and so generous. He's offered this to take all the shame that we deserve for all of our sinfulness. The two sons show us two options. Either we ask Jesus to take our burden and have it lifted like the younger son, or we carry the burden with us and stay separated from the Father forever. Which son are you like? Are you like the younger son? Have you realized you're a sinner and need to be set free? Or are you like the older brother? Maybe you think you're good enough and you don't need God's gift of salvation. I want to offer us a time to pray right now. Maybe this parable has spoke to you and you've realized that I'm a sinner too. And I've acted as though I don't need God my whole life. But today I want to get right with God and I want to ask Him to lift the burden of sin from me. I'm going to pray. There's nothing magical about my prayer. But I want to pray with you, and if you want to give your life to Christ right now, you want Him to take the burden of sin that you're carrying and live a life with Him as Lord, then I want you to pray your own special prayer to God. But it'll give you a model to kind of go after. Lord, Father, I pray, Father, that the burden of sin that I've been carrying around is lifted, Lord. I realize that every single day I sin because I'm a sinner. But the only way that I can come back into your presence to be in a relationship with you is to let you take that burden. And so today, Lord, I give you my life. Today, I recognize that you are Lord, Lord over all, including me. That's it. You just got to mean it from the heart. Head knowledge doesn't save anybody. It's got to go from here to here to here. Enjoy.
In Kenya, we have communities that they do not speak Swahili. We have communities that, of course, cannot interact with God's word in English. And therefore, for many years, God has been a foreign God to them. They cannot relate with a God who does not speak their language. They don't even know that God because God reveals Himself through the written word. I am seeing God moving in a very marvelous and wonderful way in Bible translation in Kenya, where Bible translation has become actually a national conversation. We've seen the church just get a grip of the passion of wanting to have God's people receive God's word in their language in Kenya. And not only the church, but also government officials who've come through to make sure that there's no community in Kenya that does not have God's word in their language. Once we complete a portion of a book or the New Testament, either in audio or in a text form, really being received so enthusiastically by the communities. We've just dedicated the Giriama Bible That actually was a partnership between BTL and the Wycliffe US. We printed 4,000 copies. People are reading God's word. I can see great transformation in some of those communities. If you speak to a man through a foreign language, that goes to his head. If you speak to that same man in their language, it goes to his heart. Translating God's word in the heart's language of the people is so important because we want them to hear God speak to their heart.
Stay.
What's it doing? What's happening?
It won't stay.
Oh.
I'm trying to figure out.
I'll help it.
Oh, that worked.
Sort of.
Yeah.
Okay. Hey, guess what time it is?
Oh, it's time for science experiments with Tracker.
That's not correct. Should we try it again?
Here. Come here.
What?
Watch this. Just wait.
Oh, no.
Watch this. Okay, here it goes. Wait.
Is it sticking?
Stay. Now it'll stay. That's awesome. Wow. I think our viewership's going to go up with this one. Wow, that's really cool.
That's your hair looks staticky.
Your hair looks electrifying. Good job. Okay, now do it.
It's time for
Trivia with me and Tara and Mr. Malone. Yeah, you look great. Yeah.
Okay.
Why do we have all these? Wow. Yeah, we need hair. Oh, it's got me. Okay, why do we have all these balloons?
Well, you want to know why? Because it has to do with our lesson for today.
Really?
Yes.
That's awesome. What? Let's talk about it.
We're just going to move that over there.
Aw, man.
You're telling me.
That was fun.
Okay, so today we learned about some really special people, okay?
Okay.
So what did the younger son want from his father?
Oh, we're talking about prodigal son?
Prodigal son.
Yeah, he went to his dad. He says, Dad, show me the money.
Your coin there?
Yeah, show me the money. He wanted his inheritance.
Mm-hmm. He did.
Yeah.
So he wanted money and the valuable items from his dad, like before his dad even died.
Yeah.
That's not very nice.
Not very smart, I don't think.
Mm-mm.
No.
Okay, so what happened? So what did the younger son do with everything that his father gave him? Was he like wise with the money?
He went and like...
Did he invest it?
No, he went and blew it all.
He did?
Like, yeah, it was kind of like he just went and spent all the money and he lost it.
Oh no!
Yeah.
What was he thinking?
I don't know, but when he was eating with the pigs, that was pretty gross.
Ugh.
Pigs smell. Mm-hmm. Not like camels. We smell sweet.
Leave that up to you.
We do.
Okay. So, what did the younger son decide to do when he ran out of all the money? When he was laying with the pigs and he was eating their food, what?
I think he realized that he messed up and he should go back home to his dad. And yeah, he had to kind of like go back and humble himself, mm-hmm, and say sorry and stuff like that.
Yeah, and he told his dad he was going to ask his dad for a job,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, exactly.
Because even they ate better than him.
Yeah, exactly. That's right. Good job.
Exactly. Okay, so then what did the father do when his younger son came back home?
He went, hey, look over there. And then they went, I'm just joking. Okay, illustration. Okay, and he's like, wow, hey, there's my son. And he's like, whoa, over here. And his son came and he wrapped him and he hugged him. Yeah, it's kind of like that balloon. And it just hugged to him. Yeah, he just held him close.
He held him. And then he threw a big
party.
Big party.
Yeah,
yes,
it's kind of like all the, balloons, a big party, but. And wait, why do we have all these balloons?
Well, you know, these balloons down here, these are like the heavy burdens we have.
That
right?
Looks heavy.
This is like what the younger son was carrying when he just left and he was with the pigs, right? But then what does God do? He lifts our burdens.
That's awesome.
Right?
Can you drop one of those heavy ones?
No.
Why not? Are they water balloons?
It's
Are they water?
It's a heavy.
That's heavy.
Water.
That's water. Yeah. We don't want those kind of burdens.
Mm-mm. No, we don't. Okay. So why was the older son mad and think that he deserved a party?
Because he thought the party should be with him because he stuck around.
Yeah.
And he walked up and he's like, hey, there's a party going on right here. A celebration.
Yeah.
To last throughout the years. You know? And he's like, that should have been my celebration.
Yeah. That is very true. Yeah. And he kept working for his dad the whole time. And it was like, that's not fair.
Not fair.
Not fair.
Nope.
Right? Okay. So even though the father clearly loved both sons, right? He loved the younger son.
Yeah.
And he still loved the older son.
Yeah.
He loved both of them. Okay. So... even though he loved them both, did either of them really deserve the gifts and the party that the father threw them?
Not really. It's kind of like us and Guy. We don't deserve it, but God loves us anyways, just like the dad loved his sons.
So true.
Yeah.
Okay, so our last question. Do we deserve God's gift of salvation for our sins?
No, I'm kind of like those balloons way down there at times. Yeah, I make mistakes. Yeah, you should. Yeah, you should not.
No. Exactly. We don't deserve it, but we have such a loving God who loves us so much. And think about that this week on Deal at Home.
Wow, that's really cool. Bye-bye, everybody. Can we pop them now?
Yep.
Yeah, okay. Ah!
Confessing our sins isn't just about, oh, let's get it right with God. It also gives us the ability to just rise up and sing throughout the day. That burden's been lifted. We have that burden of sin that keeps us away from God, but then when we confess that sin and He makes us His child, when we sin again, it can feel like a burden on the relationship. Getting that burden off by confessing our sins to God helps us to rise and sing every day. Oh, that reminds me of a song. Let's do Rise and Sing together.
Boys and girls, no matter what you are going through, we can always trust in the Lord. Let's sing Trust in the Lord.
Mm-hmm. in all your ways. Acknowledge him, and he will make your path straight.
Of the jungle. Boys and girls, welcome back to DL at Home. I'm so glad you're here with us today. Let's go ahead and let's open up in prayer. Remember, when we're praying, we're just talking to God. So let's show respect to God by folding our hands and closing our eyes and bowing our head. Do it with us, girls.
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for today. Thank you that we get to come together to learn more about you and to worship you. We thank you, Father God, that you love us so much that no matter what kind of sin we do, that you will forgive us of our sins. Help us to remember to try always to do our best, to turn away from sin, and that you always love us. In your name we pray.
Amen.
Now, question for you. Hadley has this big book right here. What is this book called?
The Bible!
Yes, that's right. It is called the Bible. And show me, boys and girls, is everything in our Bible true? So it's not made up, or is it false? Like fake, made up. What do you think? Show me with your thumbs. Yes, that's right. Everything in our Bible is true. And it's pretty big. And so they have broken our Bible up into how many parts?
I think 10 or 2.
Oh, 10 or 2. What do you think?
I think it's 2.
I think 2. Show me with your fingers. Yes, 2 parts. And let's say those parts together. We have the Old Testament and the New Testament. Our lesson today comes from the book of Luke. So would that be in the Old Testament?
No.
Or would it be in the New Testament?
New Testament!
That's right. Let's say the books of the Bible all the way up to Luke. Are you ready?
Matthew, Mark, Luke.
Good job. Okay, now you know what? Right before this, I was talking to Tracker. And Tracker told me he did something. His parents told him that he could not ride his bike outside. And you know what? Tracker took his bike and he went and rode his bike outside.
That's not good.
No, that's not. Sin. And you know what? That is a sin. And Tracker ended up getting lost. Oh. Well, his parents went looking for him, and they finally found him, and they gave him a really big hug. And Tracker admitted, he confessed to his parents. He said, "Yes, I did wrong. I disobeyed you." That's what our lesson is going to be about today. How when we disobey, we need to confess what we have done wrong.
Confess.
Wow. So Tracker did do wrong, but he told his parents and he asked for forgiveness. So let's find out what our story is about today. So here's a story that Jesus told. And we're actually going to be reading from Luke chapter 15, verse 11 through 12. Hadley, can you read that for us? It's right here.
Jesus continued, "There was a man who had 2 sons. The younger one said to his father, 'Father, give me my share of the estate.' So he divided his property between them."
Okay, so there was a son, right? And the father had a lot of money. And the one son went to his father and said, "Hey, you know what? I want all of my money.
I want all my money."
So the one son, he wanted all of the money. So the father, he did give him all of the money. And then the son decided to leave with all of the money. Well, that kind of probably made the dad feel sad. The dad gave him all the money, and then the son left. Well, he didn't really care. He went out, and he started to have fun. He started to spend this money on things. He was buying things for himself. He was buying things for his friends. He was having parties. He was blowing this money left and right, and pretty soon, shake it, he spent all of his money. And that's pretty sad. That is awful. He had no more money. He had no more friends. He had no more food. Now, what was he going to do?
Oh, dear. Maybe we should keep reading to find out.
Here is a pig. You know what? And he knew he needed a job. He knew he needed a job so he could pay for things and so he could eat. So he started working like with the pigs, and he looked at the food the pigs were eating, and he thought, "Oh, I kind of am so hungry. I want to eat what the pigs are eating." That's kind of gross, isn't it? Is that gross?
Yeah,
I think that's kind of gross. You know what? He had made some sinful choices. He made some bad choices. When we make bad choices, we are sinning. Oh, let's find out what happens in Luke 15, 17 through 20.
"When he came to his senses, he said, 'How many of my father's hired men have food to spare, and here I'm starving to death? I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men.' So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way from his
father... No, okay, we'll stop right there. Okay, so the son knew he sinned, and he knew he did not deserve to be called a son anymore. But he knew he should go back home and apologize to his father. See, he sinned. He made poor choices. But he wanted to go back home, and he wanted to ask for forgiveness. Did he know he sinned?
Yes, he did know.
See, Tracker knew he sinned. And this son, he knew he sinned as well. So, he's going to go back home. Let's see what happens. So, this is Luke 15:20b now, Hadley.
Uh-huh. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him.
Wow! So the father wasn't angry. He wasn't mad. He was happy, right, Hadley?
Yeah,
he was showing happy. See, and that's how God feels, boys and girls. When we turn to God and we realize we have sinned and we run to God and we say, God, I'm sorry for sinning. That's how God feels. He wants to give us a great big hug because we have chosen to realize that we've sinned and we're turning away from it. That's exactly how God feels. I wonder what happens next. Okay? The son knew he sinned, and he went back to his father, and he confessed his sins. Let's read Luke 15:22 through 23.
But the father said to his servants, "Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate."
Oh, so the father is so happy at his home. He's not mad at his son. In fact, he's throwing him a party. Look at that, a party. Put your party hats on. The father was so happy that his son returned. He wanted everyone to know that his son was back home. Put it on.
There we go.
And he celebrated. Yes. Okay, put it down. That's how God feels, boys and girls. When we ask God to forgive us of our sins, he's celebrating. He's throwing a party. I want you to think, have you sinned? Have we all sinned?
We've all sinned.
Yeah, because Romans 3:23 tells us, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." You see, boys and girls, God loves us so much. So much. And when we turn to God and confess that we have sinned, he's throwing a party. He is happy. Just like this father was happy that his son came back home, God feels the exact same way, probably even more. So he told his dad he sinned. Tracker told his dad he sinned. Boys and girls, if you do something at home, maybe you touch something you're not supposed to do.
Like touch a cookie. Or sneak something you're not supposed to sneak.
Or watch a show you're not supposed to watch. You know what? You need to go and confess that to your parents because they're the ones that told you not to do it. But you also need to confess that to God. Give everything back to God. Boys and girls, our God is so loving. He loves us and he takes care of us so much. And this week, I want you to remember, when you do wrong, I want you to confess it to God. Boys and girls, let's review. Let's see how well you listen to our lesson. Girls, what we're going to do is when I ask you a question, if you get the answer correct, you're going to take one of the gold coins and put it into our bucket. You can do this at home as well, boys and girls. If you have coins laying around or any kind of tokens, when you answer the question, put it into the middle of a bucket. All right, here we go. First question. Harper, I'm going to ask you, what did the younger son want from his father? Did he want money or did he want a new bike?
Money.
He wanted money. Good job. Put it into our bowl. Hadley.
Yes.
What did the younger son do with the money his father gave him? Did he spend it all or did he put it into the bank?
He spent it all.
All right, put it in the bowl. Next one. Ooh, Harper. When the son ran out of money, did he run out of food to eat?
No.
When he ran out of the money, did he also run out of food to eat?
Uh-huh.
Yes, he did. All right, put it in. Okay, Hadley.
Yes.
What did the son find for a job? Was it feeding pigs or working at a grocery store?
feeding pigs.
Feeding pigs. Let's just put it in. There we go. All right, Harper, what did the younger son decide to do? Did he decide to go back home to his father? Or did he decide to go and play some football? What did he do?
I would choose football.
He decided to go back home to his father. All right, Hadley.
Yes.
Did the son tell his dad that he had sinned?
Yes, he did.
Yes, he did. Okay, Harper, what did the father do when his younger son came back home?
He celebrated.
He celebrated. You're right. Last one, Hadley.
Okay.
After he forgave him, did he give him a job or throw him a party?
A party!
A party! And you know what? When the son came back home, the father celebrated and forgave him. All right, boys and girls, have a great week.
Bye!